With the help of Hashem, we are starting the class today, Parashat Vayera. I want to read from the Ramban, the commentary of the Ramban on the Parasha. But before we starting this commentary, I want to speak a little bit about who was the Ramban and why we are reading his commentary.
Con ayuda de Dios, vamos a empezar a ver la Parashat Vayera. Vamos a ver los comentarios de Ramban con la de la parasha de la semana. Pero antes de empezar, vamos a hablar sobre quién era Ramban.
So the Ramban, we know, was one of the Rishonim. He was living around 800 years ago. And the interesting point that I want to speak about is that the Arizal defines the Ramban as the last of the Mekubalim.
Ramban es una persona que vivió hace 800 años. Es uno de los Rishonim. Y algo interesante de él es que el Arizal lo define a él como el último de los Mekubalim.
So, what does it mean that the Ramban is the last one of the Mekubalim? We know that there was many Mekubalim before, after the Ramban, before the Arizal, after the Arizal. But the Arizal is speaking about a certain tradition of Kabbalah that is referring to that as a true, real Kabbalah, that the Ramban was the last one to carry the lineage of this specific inheritance of Kabbalah.
Cuando hablamos de Kubalim, obviamente sigue habiendo muchas personas que se definen como tal hasta nuestras épocas. Pero lo que quiere decir la Arizal cuando lo llama el último de los Mekubalim, se refiere al hecho de que él carga una linaje muy particular, especial, de Kabbalah, que termina con él y no es transmitida ya a otras personas.
So the we actually have the Rambam and the Ramban, right? The Rambam, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, and the Ramban, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, that they were living very close one to another. And the Arizal is saying that really the Ramban and the Rambam, they were parallel in their spiritual level. That the Rambam was in, both of them in very, very high level. The Rambam in the left side and the Ramban in the right side. And here in this parasha, we have actually like an argument between the Rambam and the Ramban.
El Ramban y el Rambam, Nachmanides y Maimonides, vivieron durante la misma época cercana y vivieron en lugares cercanos. Vemos, el Arizal menciona que Rambam se encarga, es muy fuerte espiritualmente del lado izquierdo, y Rambam es muy fuerte del lado derecho. Ellos teniendo niveles similares de espiritualidad.
So, what is the argument all about? That we see in the parasha that Avraham Avinu, he had a vision of angels, right? So the argument is about how does it work? When you have a vision of angels, you see angels. There is angels physically, it's only conceptually. How does it work?
Ramban y Rambam tienen en esta parasha una discusión que trae Ramban a la mesa de cómo es que Abraham Avinu ve a los ángeles. ¿Cómo es que funciona estas visiones?
So, let's start with the approach of the Rambam. The Rambam, he writes that we don't have a commentary of the Rambam on the Torah, but in the Moreh Nevuchim of the Rambam, he writes about the parasha.
Rambam escribe sobre en Moreh Nevuchim, su libro, sobre esta parasha con respecto a este tema.
So we know that it speaks about in the parasha that Avraham Avinu, he saw three people, and all those three people were angels. So the Rambam in Moreh Nevuchim, he said that all of this is the vision of prophecy. Okay, that's the approach of the Rambam, that all of what happened, all of the conversation between Abraham and the angels was a vision of Abraham Avinu.
Rambam sostiene que Abraham Avinu y los tres invitados que tuvo después de su brit fue una visión totalmente. Todas las conversaciones y toda la perashá, esta parte es una visión completamente.
And so to make it more clear, the Rambam obviously doesn't argue that there is existence of angels. The Rambam agrees that there is existence of angels. The question is, are they taking a physical form, or they are only spiritual identities, and they come to the person in a way of prophecy?
Rambam tiene la pregunta. Él sostiene que todos los ángeles vienen de una forma totalmente visión, que no toman una forma física per se. Okay.
So basically, the Ramban that we are concentrating about, his commentary in the Torah now, is arguing with that concept, and he says, according to what the Rambam is telling us, so it means that Avraham Avinu didn't run to prepare them food, and Sarah didn't prepare them bread, and Avraham Avinu didn't slaughter do shechita with the cows. All of those things, it was only like conceptually, only in the vision of Avraham Avinu. It never really happened in the physical.
Rambam se pregunta, ¿cómo puede ser que todas estas cosas que hizo Abraham Avinu por sus invitados, como ir a matar al ganado, como Sara preparando el pan, cómo puede ser que esto sea completamente teórico, no haya sido una visión realmente y no sea tomado literalmente?
And the same argument is not only about this case, is also about, for example, when Yaakov Avinu was fighting with the angel of Esav. So also that, according to the Rambam, it is only conceptually. The fight is in the spiritual realm, is not in the physical. And the Ramban is asking the Rambam if that's the case. So like, what made Yaakov Avinu to not walk properly afterwards? Why we're not eating the Gid and Asher, according to that, if nothing happened physically?
Entonces, hay otro lugar donde sugiere esta problemática, que es donde Jacob Avinu pelea con el ángel de Esav. La pregunta es, ¿cómo puede ser que si no es algo físico, es que Jacob Avinu se queda cojo, que ya no puede caminar?
So, and the same thing also about Lot in the parasha, that the angels were going, they went to destroy the Sodom, and they took Lot. So Lot, if the angel didn't come in the physical, so what happened with Lot? They didn't take him out of his house. He was not running away. All of that was only a spiritual vision that never happened in the reality. So the Ramban is like signing that argument, and he says that those things is contradiction of the writings, and no one should believe that. Okay, it's a very harsh thing to say about the Rambam, right? We say that's the reason I said in the beginning the Rambam was one of the greatest, right? But there is a contradiction here, and the Ramban is arguing with the Rambam, and he pushed that opinion away.
En el caso de Lot también vemos que los ángeles llegaron a Sedom y sacaron a Lot de su casa y lo sacaron de la ciudad. ¿Cómo puede ser que digamos que esto no sucedió, que no pasó todo esto más que conceptualmente, visual, en visiones? Argumenta contra Rambam diciendo que no se puede en absoluto creer en lo que dice Rambam, Maimónides, que los ángeles y cualquier situación con ángeles es puramente visiones.
So basically, the Ramban is saying that there is one thing that is prophecy. That's one thing that we need to address and understand like what is it, how does it work? And there is a different thing of seeing angels. And he says that those cases in the Torah that, or the Tanakh, that people saw angels, not all of them were prophets. It's not something that is specifically for prophets. Prophet is a certain level, spiritual level. And to be able to see angels, it's not only by prophets. And the fact is, for example, in the parasha, that the people of Sodom, they were very far from being prophets. They were very low. And they saw the angels, right? The thing that happened with Lot, the people there saw the angels.
Dice Ramban que hay una división, que tiene que haber una división entre la profecía como tal y la capacidad de interactuar y ver físicamente a los ángeles. Como vemos que en Sodom, la gente de Sodom vio a los ángeles, los vio como invitados. Y aún así, ¿cómo podemos decir que no son reales?
And another proof that the Ramban is bringing is from Daniel. That we see that Daniel is part of the Ketuvim, is not part of the Nevi'im, right? So we are considering Daniel to be a prophet, but in that understanding, the Ramban says he was not a prophet. He had visions that he saw angels and he was speaking with angels, Daniel. But it's a different thing. It's not about prophecy.
That's Rambam. Daniel.
Yeah.
Rambam.
Okay. Ramban.
Ramban. So, entonces dice Nachmanides que también en Daniel vemos que Daniel ya no se considera de los Nevi'im, de los escritos de Nevi'im, que también interactúa con ángeles. Y cómo puede ser si no se. So he sees that there's a difference in Daniel, that he sees them.
Daniel, he had the ability to see angels, but he was not a prophet.
Right.
He had Daniel, very high level, but he was not a prophet.
Daniel no era profeta, no se le considera profeta. Ya pasa a otros escritos. Era un sabio de los mayores, pero aún así se considera que interactuó con los ángeles.
And the last proof that he brings, that we know that Hagar in the previous parasha, she also saw an angel, right? And we don't count Hagar as a prophet. She had the ability to see angels. She was trained in the house of Abraham Avinu. So she was able to see angels, but she was not a prophet. So that was the last proof of the Ramban. And now we want to understand more about prophecy, to understand the difference between them.
La última prueba que trae Ramban, Nachmanides, es que acá también vemos que ve e interactúa con un ángel, pero a ella no se le considera ninguna forma profeta.
So now, to understand prophecy, we're starting with the highest level of prophecy. Who was the highest level of prophecy that we know? Moshe Rabbeinu, right? Chazal is telling us that the prophecy of Moshe Rabbeinu was higher than all of the prophecy of all of the higher prophets. And they say that the difference between them, that all of the prophecies, they saw something that is called aspaklaria she'ina meira. Okay, I will explain the concept. And Moshe Rabbeinu, he had a level that is called aspaklaria meira. Okay, aspaklaria, it means like a window or mirror. So you can see through a window that is dirty, and you can see through a window that is clear, that you don't see the glass. So the prophecy of Moshe Rabbeinu was like a clear window. So you don't see the glass. You see directly what there is in the other side. The prophecy of the other prophets, even though they had prophecy, but it was not as clear. It was like a little dim.
Vemos que el profeta más grande de todos es Abraham Avinu. Vamos a explicar cómo es que se difiere su profecía entre los otros profetas. Vemos que hay un concepto que se llama aspaklaria shenei.
Moshe Rabbeinu aspaklaria meira. The other prophets aspaklaria sheina meira.
La aspaklaria meira significa que puedes ver a través de una ventana. La definición aspaklaria es una ventana por la que se puede ver. Entonces decimos que Moshe Rabbeinu, cuando está creada Meira, podía ver todo súper claro. No tenía ninguna estorbo entre su visión y todo lo que podía ver. Mientras los otros profetas, podríamos decir que la ventana por la que veían tenía un espejo que filtraba un poco la luz.
So, about Moshe Rabbeinu, it says, Tumunat Hashem Yabit. What does it mean, Tumunat Hashem Yabit? He had the prophecy as if the picture that Hashem gives him directly. Okay, it's not that he had the picture of Hashem, because Hashem doesn't have a picture, but he had he was able to see clear vision of the picture that Hashem is giving him. So this is mean the what the Torah is telling us about the prophecy of Moshe Rabbeinu, Tumunat Hashem Yabit.
Moshe Rabbeinu tenía la capacidad de ver todo claro como Hashem se lo estaba entregando. A esto se le llama, how do you call it?
Tumunat Hashem Yabit.
Tumunat Hashem Anit.
Yabit.
So it means clarity, complete clarity.
That he see the picture that Hashem gives him clear.
Que él ve la imagen que Hashem le manda completamente clara, mientras los otros no lo ven claro.
And also about Moshe Rabbeinu, and also about other prophets, that they had different levels of prophecy, with not speaking about seeing angels. That's a different subject. It's a different thing.
En el tema de los profetas, no estamos hablando de que si ven ángeles o no. Vemos aquí que ver ángeles es otro tema, es otra cosa.
Now, another point that is interesting to bring into the discussion is Bilam. Bilam was a wicked guy, right? He wanted to curse the Jewish people. He was hiring his services to curse people. It's not such a great thing. And he was still a prophet. He's called a prophet. So how can it be? How can it be that you have someone that is wicked like Bilam and you have prophecy?
Otro punto es que Bilam vemos que se le llama profeta, una persona que usaba sus servicios para maldecir a otros, y aún así le llamamos profeta.
So Chazal is obviously addressing that question, and they say that really Bilam was not supposed to receive prophecy. The reason that he got prophecy is because that if there was no prophet except of Am Israel, so then the other nations would have said, why in the end of time, why the Jewish people went in the way of Hashem? Because they had prophets that would lead them, and we didn't have a prophet, so that's why we did what we did. So Hashem says, Hashem will tell them, that's what the Chazal is telling us, Hashem will tell them, I gave you a prophet here, you see, Bilam was a prophet. Obviously, it's not only Bilam. There is all kinds of different individuals through the history of the world that had certain levels of prophecy, also by non-Jews. But from the same answer that Chazal is telling us about Bilam, we can understand also about many, many other individuals.
Bilam realmente no era el merecedor de la profecía. Dice los Jajamim que la razón por la que Bilam recibe la profecía es para que los pueblos, al final de los tiempos, no lleguen y tengan una queja. Si hubiéramos tenido nosotros un profeta que nos guiara, seguramente hubiéramos podido salir adelante como Am Israel. Pero vemos que no. Y es igual esto lo que pasa con los varios profetas que hemos visto a través de la historia de las otras naciones, que no en ese nivel tenían profecía, pero si se presentan para responder, se responde su profecía con esta propuesta de que es para que las naciones no se quejen.
Now, another subject that is also connected with that is prophecy like Nebuchadnezzar or Paro, right? They went to sleep and they had a vision in their dream that is actually a prophecy, right? That afterwards, Daniel was explaining the prophecy for Nebuchadnezzar and Yosef was explaining the prophecy for Paro. So they had the vision of prophecy, even though they didn't have the meaning. So we see that there is a possibility of someone to receive a vision without understanding what the vision means. He doesn't know what does it mean. He needs someone else that is a wise person that will explain to him.
Vemos a través de Paro y Nebuchadnezzar que también existe la capacidad de tener profecía, una imagen mandada de Hashem, y no necesariamente entender qué significa. Lo vemos con que Nebuchadnezzar buscó a Moshe, a Daniel, y el faro buscó a Yosef Avinu, Yosef Tzadik.
So, what does it mean, a wise person? Like, it says about Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar said about Daniel that I see that you have the Ruach Elohim, that you have the spirit of Hashem in him. Nebuchadnezzar was saying that about Daniel, the same thing Paro was saying about Yosef. So we know that Irat Hashem hi chokhmah. Someone that have very, very strong Irat Shemayim, that is the real wisdom. And someone that they have that level of Irat Shemayim, so then is able to have the understanding of all visions because he have that connection with Hashem.
Nebuchadnezzar y Faro llaman a Daniel y a Yosef, les dicen que yo veo que el espíritu de Hashem está con ustedes. Y vemos de eso que tener el Iriat Shamayim, que tener el temor al cielo, te abre las puertas a la Jojma, a la sabiduría, para poder entender todas las visiones y toda la realidad.
So, we see. We see that there is a prophecy like Paro and Nebuchadnezzar, that also them, they were not like high level of their character, right? They didn't work on their tikkun amidot so much, quite the opposite. And still they had prophecy. So that is a different case. It's not like Bilam, because they were in a position of a king of the world, right? But all in his time, the Egypt was the biggest country, the strongest country. So he was like the king of the whole world, the known world. Same thing with Nebuchadnezzar. He was the strongest king in his time. So someone like that is in a very high position, that is controlling that the known world. So that is also a reason that Hashem is giving him a vision. Not because of him, because of his responsibility for the world. So someone that is taking a lot of responsibility for many people, for the world, so it might be that he will have a prophecy, even though he is not worthy, because of his position.
Diferencian estos dos reyes conforme en torno a Bilam, ya que ellos tuvieron profecía, pero no necesariamente por los mismos propósitos de Bilam. Sus visiones les llegaron porque son ellos reyes encargados de muchas personas, y vemos que los reyes reciben gente que tiene tanto poder, recibe imágenes de Hashem para ser interpretadas.
Now let's go back to Abraham Avinu. We say that Abraham Avinu, he had the vision of angels, and with the vision of the angels he had also prophecy, right? Abraham Avinu, he had both, right? So again, we have the prophecy, we have two parts, okay? The sight, to be able to see the vision. And another thing is to understand what the vision means. That's two parts within prophecy. Besides that, we have to be able to see angels. That's a different quality. And we learn that Abraham Avinu, he had all of those qualities. Also prophet ascending, and also he was able to understand, to see angels.
Hay dos partes, estamos viendo que hay dos partes de la profecía. Uno es ver imágenes, ver la imagen que manda Dios Hashem. La segunda es entenderlas. Por aparte está la capacidad de ver ángeles. Two things. See the prophecy, understanding the prophecy, and seeing angels.
Yes.
Okay. Vemos que Abraham Avinu era capaz de hacer las tres.
Now, the Ramban, in his commentary, is saying that there is a certain site that is called Galui Enayim. Okay, what is Galui Enayim? So literally it will mean revelation of the eyes, that there is something that the sight is revealing to the eyes, something that usually the eyes cannot see. Okay, and that we see, for example, by Bilam, that Bilam, it says about him that he was a Galui Enayim, that he had the ability to have to see with his eyes something that other people don't see.
We're saying that this Galui Enayim,
that's a certain level of prophecy.
Hay un nivel de profecía que se llama Galui Enayim, que significa literalmente la revelación del ojo. Vemos que Bilam tenía esta capacidad.
And also about Elisha, he was praying on someone and he was asking Hashem, please give this person that level of revelation to the eyes that he will be able to see that thing that he needed to see. If you want to look at that, that's in Melachim Bet 6:17. Elisha.
Vemos que Elisha también tenía esta capacidad de ver algo más allá de lo que la gente normal podía ver. Si quieren ver más sobre esto, pueden irse a Melahim, Yud 6:73.
Now about the angels. So we see that in this parasha and few other places, the Torah is not calling the angels, it's not called Malach. Sometimes the Torah, the Tanakh, is calling the angel Ish. Okay, Anashim. Avraham Avinu, it says in the parasha that he saw Anashim. And also about Yaakov Avinu, it says that he was fighting Yavek Ish Imo, was fighting with Ish. So sometimes we're calling an angel Ish. Now what does it mean? What's the difference?
Vemos en la parasha con Avraham Avinu que le llama a los tres ángeles, a las tres personas que se presentan, personas, Anashim. Y a la persona, y en Yaakov Avinu vemos que cuando se pelea con el ángel, le llama al ángel Ish, que significa hombre.
So that's the big chidush of the Ramban, that is the answer to the Rambam that we started with, that he says that whenever the Torah or the Tanakh is using the term Ish to describe an angel, it means that the spiritual angel took like a garment of human body, and then with the garment of human body, so anyone will be able to see that. Even someone that is not capable, is not Jewish, is not in a spiritual level, it's possible to see an angel when he's taking a form of human body. There is a reality like that.
Ramban menciona que cuando la Torah habla así de un ángel como Anashim o Yish, significa que su fuerza espiritual le ponen una ropa física, y esto significa que cualquier persona puede verlo, y en todo el Tanaj se ve esto.
So in other words, the Ramban is not really arguing that what the Rambam writes is a possibility. It's true that there is a possibility that the angels will be seen in a form like a sight of prophecy when they're not taking a garment of physical. Okay, but the Ramban is saying that here in this parasha you cannot say that, because otherwise you're losing the whole like what happened there. Right, all of the story that we learn in the parasha, you don't have it if you see that, if you said that everything was just prophecy. So there is something like that. It's possible to have sight of angels that they are not taking the physical form, and that will be like prophecy, spiritual sight. And there is also reality, like in this parasha, like in other places, that we are using the term of Ish, not Malach, that means that the angel took a form of human body, and then it can act like a human, like the angels are eating with Avraham Avinu, right? So they're acting like humans.
Vemos que vemos que hay, dice Ramban, que no hay una discusión totalmente con lo que dice Maimónides. Dice que sí hay una posibilidad de ver la profecía y ver ángeles de forma profética y interpretarlo a partir de eso. Pero también hay que tomar en cuenta que tras tantas pruebas, vemos que también los ángeles pueden tomar una forma humana en la que podemos interactuar con ellos.
So there is just to finish that point, we see that Avraham Avinu, he prepared food to the angels and they ate. And we see that there was another case of Manoach and his wife, the parents of Shon HaGibor. So they prepared food to the angel and he didn't eat. Okay, he vanished before, instead of eating, he vanished. So there is an interesting point about it, that what's the difference? Why the angels ate by Avraham Avinu and why they didn't eat by Manoach?
Hay un caso con los padres de Shimshon, que cuando llegó el ángel, le prepararon comida al ángel. El ángel decidió, simplemente no comió y se desvaneció. Mientras con Abraham vino, sí, se sentaron y comieron con él. Y aquí hay un mensaje importante y un detalle que hay que mencionar.
So, the Ramban in the parasha is mentioning that, but it doesn't explain that. He says that if you will have the merit, you will be able to understand why the angels didn't eat by Manoach and he vanished, like disappeared. So it doesn't explain. But I want to explain that last point, and with that we will finish the class, and then I will give some time for questions with the help of Hashem.
Ramban dice que no va a explicar por qué es la diferencia, nomás lo menciona. Dice que aquel que tiene el mérito de entenderlo, pues lo va a entender. Y ahora el rabino va a explicar un punto sobre esto y una explicación sobre ello.
So, there is, as you know, or maybe you don't know, but I'll tell you now. There is meditations in the Kabbalah for everything, okay? One of the things that there is a lot of meditations about is for eating. There's many meditations, it's called Kavanot Achila, the meditation for eating. So within the meditations of eating, that it's brought down in the Sidur HaRashash, the Arizal explains it, there is the meditation of eating of Manoach, and there is meditations of eating of Avraham Avinu.
En la Kabbalah hay meditación para todo, es lo que hemos visto con Rav Shepard. Vemos que hay una meditación para el tema de comer con los ángeles y una con Manoah, y el tema de no comer con Manoah y un tema de comer con Abraham Avinu. So there's a subject of eating with Abraham Avinu and a subject of not eating with Manoah.
So there is, Manoah and Abraham Avinu, the fact that they had both of them, they had like that scenario of giving food to the angel. So in the way of the Kabbalah, we explain that not only as a physical scenario that happened in the history, we also explain that it is a whole set of meditations, the set of meditation of the eating that Avraham Avinu is related with, and a whole set of meditations for eating that Manoach is related with.
Es un set completamente de meditaciones respecto a Abraham Avinu, que comen los ángeles, y de Manoah, que no comen los ángeles. Okay.
So there is obviously a lot of details that I cannot explain right now, but I'm just saying that there is a different, it's two different levels. The level of the meditations of Avraham Avinu, of the eating, is much, much higher. And there is Sidurim that they didn't write the meditation of the eating of Avraham Avinu, only the meditations of Manoach, because they understand that this is meditations that are relevant for most of the people. This is something that is more relevant. But the meditation of Avraham Avinu is very, very high, very, very lofty. So many sidurim that they write the meditations of the eating, they didn't write it.
Muchos sidurim que mencionan la meditación del comer, y hace referencia a estos dos aspectos, solo escriben la meditación de Manoah, ya que la meditación de Abraham Avinu es demasiado elevada y no es apta para la mayoría de la gente. La mayoría de la gente puede lidiar nada más con la meditación de Manoah.
So, when I published my Sidur, I was arguing with the person that was doing the typesetting for me. I wanted to put in the meditation of Abraham Avinu also, and he said, no, it's Sidur for beginners, just leave it with just meditation of Manoah, it's enough. And we left it this way. But Bezrat Hashem, I hope that one day we will have the opportunity to go deeper to the technical meditations and to understand all the details of the meditation, also of Manoah, also of Abraham Avinu. But for now, we will leave it with this. So if there is questions, now it's the time to ask them.
Cuando Rav Shepherd hizo su sidur, él quería poner las meditaciones también de Abraham Avinu, y la persona que estaba acomodando el texto dijo, no es, es suficiente las de Manoah, no necesitas, es demasiado avanzado, estás haciendo un sidur para principiantes, no vale la pena poner el de Abraham Avinu. Y al final al cabo, Rav Shepherd accedió y dejó nada más el de la meditación de la comida de Manoah. Cualquier pregunta que tengan, por favor, pregunten ahora. ¿Alguna pregunta? Creo que están todos en mute. No sé si quieren quitar.
Yes, Laila Tov for you. Just a little question. We heard in the parasha that first the Shekhinah come to Abraham Avinu, and he start talking with the Creator. Then come the Malachim, and they start talking with the Malachim. Abraham Avinu start talking with the Malachim, and between them there is a conversation that Hashem is saying about Sarah, that she's in the behind the curtain and everything, and it's like Hashem is talking. My question is, the part of Hashem talking with Abraham Avinu was a kind of understanding with the Shekhinah, listen the Shekhinah, or the three messengers, the three angels, the three Malachim were saying also the part of Hashem, of the Shekhinah.
Okay, so say it in Spanish and then I will answer.
Okay. Mi pregunta es si es que en la parasha se escucha que primero la Shekhinah posa sobre Abraham Avinu y él empieza a interactuar con la Shekhinah y después ve a los tres ángeles acercarse, que los ve como hombres, y se acerca a ellos y empieza a hablar con ellos. Entonces hay como una parte que habla con la Shekhinah y hay otra parte que está hablando con el Creador y otra parte que está hablando con los ángeles, pero después en la medio de la conversación empiezan a hablar sobre Sara, sobre que va a quedar embarazada, y mi pregunta es si se ve que como que el Creador le va hablando, pero no sé si es que él sigue escuchando interactuando directamente con el Creador independientemente de los ángeles, o es a través de esos ángeles que están ahí que empieza él a hablar con también a través de ellos, ¿no? con el Creador.
So the answer is that, like that's what I was saying, that Abraham Avinu, he had also the sight of the angels, but also he had prophecy. So to hear the voice of Hashem, this is prophecy. This is not seeing angels, right? So when Abraham Avinu is speaking with Hashem, also in the beginning of the parasha, before he saw the angels, he was speaking with Hashem. Hashem came to comfort him after the Brit Milah. That's the beginning of the parasha. And then, right? So there is the vision. There is within, okay, so that's really, I didn't explain that point, that within prophecy, there is prophecy by sight and there is prophecy by hearing. So that's another point. That in that point, that what you're asking about is a kind of prophecy that Abraham Avinu had, it is not sight, is hearing, a voice. But this is also kind of a prophecy.
Vemos que lo que estamos hablando de que hay dos formas de profecía, de ver ángeles y aparte de hablar con ver profecía tal cual. Vemos que en el caso de Abraham Avinu, vio las dos cosas en estos momentos. También no hablamos del tema de que hay profecía por visión y también hay profecía por escuchar. Entonces sí se entiende que escuchó y habló directamente con Hashem durante el tiempo que los ángeles estaban visitándolo.
So one interesting point about it that also Sarah heard the same thing, right? So the voice was not only heard by Abraham, it was heard also by Sarah. And Chazal is telling us that really Sarah was a higher level of prophet than Abraham. Yeah. But that will be another class.
Vemos que también Sarah en estos momentos también escuchó directamente la voz de Hashem. Se entiende de esto que el nivel de profecía de Sarah era aún más grande que el nivel de Abraham, es lo que dicen los sabios. Pero eso es una clase por la parte de Hashem.
Okay. We have other questions.
¿Otras preguntas? Muy bien.
And there is a question in the chat.
A ver. A ver qué dice. Voy a repetir lo que dice el Ari sobre Rambam. Lo que dice el Ari sobre Rambam y Rambam. So he's trying to ask what's the difference between Rambam and Rambam. El Ari menciona que Rambam es el lado derecho. Y no, el Ramban, Nachmanides, es el lado derecho, y Rambam, Maimónides, es el lado izquierdo. Left is Rambam, Maimónides.
Rambam, in the left.
Dice Ari que los dos tienen el nivel espiritual de la misma, el mismo nivel, same spiritual level, right? Says Ari. Ari says they both have the same spiritual level.
Yes.
Los dos tienen el mismo nivel espiritual según el Ramban, el Ari, el este, y los dos tienen un aspecto espiritual igual, right? So, right side, left side of Ramban. Ari también menciona que Nachmanides era el último de los Mekobalim, que él, su transmisión de la Kabbalah que él tenía era, fue la única y última que tuvo de su transmisión. So he had the last transmission as a Mekubala of the Nachmanides. Rambam and Rambam, right side, left side. And what else am I missing? Okay. Si hay otra pregunta sobre el respecto, por favor, pregunte.
Okay. So if there's no other questions, so we will hold it here. And Bezrat Hashem, Friday morning, Israel time, or Thursday night for you, there will be another class of a little about Parashat Shavua and Halachot Shabbat.
Primero Dios, el jueves vamos a tener otro shiur en la noche de ustedes sobre la Parashat Shavua, la mañana del viernes de nosotros, Bezrat Hashem, la Parashat Shavua.
Toda rabá, bracha v'atzlacha, chayim tovim. We have another question in the chat, I believe.
They say how to grow spiritually if you're not in the right context. So it's another question.
Not in the right context.
Like in the right place. How can you grow spiritually if you're not in the right place?
How to grow spiritually in the right place.
In the wrong place.
Well, you have to like make the place to be right. You have to make the best out of the place where you are, and to have the desire to bring yourself, that Hashem will bring you to a better place that will be good for you.
Tienes que para crecer espiritualmente dentro de tu contexto, tienes que hacer el lugar donde estás, el lugar correcto. Y tienes que desear en tu corazón que Hashem te vaya a traer al lugar correcto donde puedas crecer. Pero de mientras, el simplemente hecho es que tu situación te hace que hagas de ese lugar el lugar correcto. Con estudio, con meditación, con búsqueda y teniendo ir a Shamay y Bitajón.
Laila Tov, Thank you very much. Baraja v'atzlacha.